Hi, I'm Liz. See that building? That's the US Embassy. When I was 6 years old, my grandma used to bring me on marches here to the Malecón, al frente de la Tribuna Antiimperialista.
Somos revolucionarios y nos cambiamos de camisa.
Fidel Castro would give speeches, but I never saw him because the crowd was too big to get close.
It was so much fun, jumping and chatting. I cannot say that yet.
But in 2014, everything changed. The two countries re-established relations. 8 months later, the U.S. Embassy officially reopened.
Dos pueblos ya no enemigos ni rivales, sino vecinos.
The goodwill didn't last long.
The U.S. believes several State Department employees at the U.S. Embassy in Havana have been subjected to acoustic attacks.
Like a Cold War spy novel.
Perhaps some sort of ultrasonic spy weapon was used.
The symptoms include hearing loss,
dizziness, headache, fatigue,
unexplained sounds in their residences.
The Cuban government either did this or they know who did it.
I do believe Cuba is responsible. I do believe that. And it's a very unusual attack.
Mysterious attacks.
Acoustic attacks.
Attacks.
Sonic attack.
Sonic attacks.
Sonic attack.
The Trump administration announced Friday that it is pulling more than half of its staff out of the American embassy in Havana.
The U.S. shut down consular services for Cubans, making it almost impossible to get a visa. Scaling down the embassy also marked an end to U.S. engagement with Cuba. Trump reversed Obama's Cuba policy, and on top of that, he imposed new sanctions that devastated our economy. COVID made things even worse.
Pero por suerte, Biden was elected.
No te adelantes a los acontecimientos. Under Biden, nothing's changed.
Tenemos que asegurarnos de que nuestro personal en la embajada no corra en peligro de un ataque de microondas, o no sé cómo lo están llamando hoy.
There is no evidence of an attack, pero ¿desde cuándo las políticas de agresión de los Estados Unidos dependen de la evidencia?
Saddam Hussein is determined to keep his weapons of mass destruction.
Weapons of mass destruction.
Weapons of mass destruction.
His Operation Iraqi Freedom has begun.
If they lied and manipulated public opinion to invade Iraq, ¿qué puede esperar esta islita del Caribe? For Johanna Tablada, hanging laundry isn't a chore. It's a moment of calm before a long day at a stressful job.
Hola!
¿Cómo estás?
Bien, bien, sube!
Johanna helps oversee relations with the U.S. at Cuba's Ministry of Foreign Affairs.
La gente se pregunta, Johanna, por fin Biden, ¿cuándo va a hacer algo? Johanna, mi hija que quiere venir, que quiero ir a ver a mis nietos, ¿cuándo van a abrir la embajada? Es todo el tiempo.
¿Y nunca te llegaron a preguntar por los incidentes de salud de los diplomáticos?
Me han preguntado poco, porque eso en Cuba nadie se lo cree.
Este es el apartamento donde vivimos nosotros.
Muy jovencitos los dos.
In the 90s, Johanna spent 4 years at the Cuban Interest Section in Washington, D.C.
Yo estuve como en 35 ciudades de Estados Unidos. Esto fue en la Cámara Estadual de Springfield, Illinois, la primera que aprobó un proyecto de ley para en favor del levantamiento de bloqueo a Cuba.
20 years later, Johanna helped lead bilateral talks after the two countries re-established relations.
Fue un momento de mucha alegría porque le había dedicado casi toda mi vida profesional a trabajar para ese día. Se dice mucho por ahí que Obama hizo grandes concesiones a Cuba. Eso no es verdad. Los dos ganamos.
¿Cuál fue la reacción del gobierno de Cuba ante la noticia de los incidentes de salud de los diplomáticos estadounidenses en Cuba?
Dijimos, estamos absolutamente dispuestos a colaborar en todo. Se hizo una investigación exhaustiva, tanto en el área de la ciencia como en el área forense, y la investigación nuestra arriba a las mismas conclusiones que después de 4 visitas a Cuba, arriba el FBI. No había evidencia que pudiese existir ningún tipo de ataque contra diplomáticos en Cuba. Cuba nunca ha cuestionado que diplomáticos estadounidenses o canadienses se pudieron sentir mal en Cuba. Una cosa son los síntomas y otra cosa son las causas. Lo que sí se puede dejar claramente es que a partir de esas acusaciones infundadas se establece la llamada política de máxima presión. Fueron a la yugular de la economía de Cuba.
Entonces, según me dices, esto fue un pretexto para las medidas que vinieron después.
Sin duda. Cuando hay 1,3 millones de personas de Estados Unidos visitando Cuba cada año, cuando hay un hotel Marriott en La Habana, cuando las universidades tienen más de 300 acuerdos y vienen estudiantes 3 y 4 veces al año a aprender español, ¿cómo a sangre fría tú puedes detener un proceso que tiene un respaldo universal?
¿Quién gana con todo esto?
Alguien debe ganar con esto, pero definitivamente no es Cuba. Cuba ha perdido mucho con esto.
The politics is easy for me to understand. The science, though, that's a more complicated story, and it begins in Miami.
Dr. Michael Hofer was the first to examine the U.S. Embassy personnel.
They, when they saw me, they just didn't feel quite right.
As a military doctor in 2009, Hofer gave an unapproved drug to U.S. soldiers suffering from traumatic brain injury in Iraq. Turns out, Hofer held 2 patents on the drug. Several years later, Hofer was pitching another product.
We expect and hope that these goggles will be on the market in the next 12 months.
Hofer used the goggles he helped invent to diagnose the U.S. personnel.
The University of Miami does concussions for a living, and that's important.
By August 2017, the State Department had moved on from Hofer. The U.S. diplomats and CIA agents were sent to the University of Pennsylvania. The UPenn investigators published their findings in the Journal of the American Medical Association, JAMA. They suggested the U.S. personnel appeared to have sustained brain injuries. Then, the State Department commissioned a study by the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering and Medicine, NASEM. NASEM concluded that microwaves were the most plausible cause of the symptoms.
We view this as plausible, but again, we didn't have any direct evidence that this could explain the entire story, or even parts of it. We were not confident.
The media, though, showed no lack of confidence in the microwave theory. And soon, reports of microwave attacks appeared everywhere.
The condition has now spread beyond Cuba to every continent.
In Vienna, China, Russia,
in India,
Uzbekistan, Bogota,
Havana Syndrome in Hanoi.
Directed pulse microwave energy.
Possible attacks are being carried out by foreigners.
Directed energy attack.
This is so weird.
The media reports may be weird, but the science isn't.
The public was being exposed to information that really was not scientifically based.
Nobody has seen the raw data. This is anti-science.
If you're going to posit a microwave weapon, you have to show that such a weapon exists.
What's your opinion of the University of Pennsylvania study?
Data was flawed. There were MRI of the brain were essentially normal. And there's absolutely no evidence that anybody has had brain damage.
They assessed these people with 37 tests. And the criterion that they used to establish that they were pathological was failing at least at one of these 37 measures. The threshold that they used was 40% of the population, which means that the authors, the editors, the US personnel, anybody tested with those criteria would be classed as pathological.
There have been reports of microwave attacks, not just in Havana, but everywhere. What do you make of this?
It has not been shown that microwaves cause the symptoms that people are describing. In order to have something happen inside someone's skull, you'd have to char the outside first. Back in the 1970s, the military asked us, can you make directed energy weapons? There were a number of people at Los Alamos who were looking into this possibility. We've been trying to do it for 50 years. It just doesn't work in the real world.
One of the big issues is mass psychogenic illness. And there have been studies suggesting about 50% of patients have symptoms and complaints where after a complete medical evaluation, no explanation for the symptoms can be found. I see patients with these symptoms on almost a daily basis, and nearly all of those are so-called psychosomatic symptoms. Most people have symptoms every day, and if you focus on them, and if you become very attentive to them, they actually become magnified.
Michel Valdez Sosa is the director of the Cuban Center for Neuroscience. He leads a team of Cuban scientists who have investigated the Havana health incidents.
Dr. Michel, did you study the diplomats?
We're never offered the opportunity of working with the clinical histories of the diplomats, the results of their images. We simply had to read what was published. Not having access to the data makes research on this topic very difficult. But it doesn't take that much research to be able to simply eliminate some of the explanations which are continuously being propelled by the media. However, trying to be heard is extremely difficult. We've written to several journals, we've written to newspapers, and most of them don't want to touch the story except if it's the official version that's being supported from the United States.
Today, Mitchell is heading to a press conference to present his team's latest report.
How is talking to the media?
The media still talks about the Havana syndrome. It's a real new disease, and this narrative has no scientific basis. It's difficult to understand how many people have swallowed this story with no critical thinking.
Okay, but why now?
It's still an obstacle to normalization of relationships between the U.S. And Cuba. So if you don't take the trouble to debunk false beliefs, they simply multiply and they can influence people. We need to set the record straight.
In 2018, Mitchell, who was born in Chicago, traveled with his team to Washington, D.C. They hoped to collaborate with U.S. doctors and scientists investigating the incidents. Instead, Mitchell says State Department officials refused their request.
Why do you think it's mistaken to refer to this phenomenon as the Havana syndrome?
All the symptoms, like vertigo, like dizziness, like sleep disorders, headaches, they're very common. So this is an heterogeneous group which could be explained by known symptoms. You can't give a name to something that doesn't exist.
¿Cómo ustedes responden a los cuestionamientos que surgen debido a la parcialidad que pudieran tener sus conclusiones, sobre todo por los vínculos de la Academia de Ciencias de Cuba con el gobierno cubano?
The same could be said about the National Academy of Sciences and their report in the States. In fact, they were paid by the State Department to make the report. So we're not saying, believe us. We're saying, let's critically examine our proposals, our explanations.
Dr. Michel, ¿qué le pareció la conferencia?
This is going to be hard because there's like a wall. The international media usually reflects what is being said in the U.S. But I think that eventually the truth will come out.
Hear that sound? Son los culpables de los supuestos ataques sónicos. Grillos. Don't believe me? Ask the State Department.
In 2018, the State Department secretly hired a group of elite scientists called JASON. Not even NASA knew about it. The JASON report found that crickets were most likely the source of the sound heard by US personnel in Havana. Microwaves were largely ruled out, and psychogenic illness was cited as a possible cause. The Trump administration buried the JASON report. 3 years later, it was revealed by journalist Dan Bergano. You think major US media outlets would pick up this story? Instead, most ignored it completely. Dylan lo tiene todo, o casi todo. She has a girlfriend, and a dog. She works as a freelance graphic designer and has a business making and selling artisanal lamps. She lives in a nice house and has a garden. But like many Cubans, she's missing something important: her family.
Hello. ¿Ya desayunaste?
Yo ya desayuné. ¿Y tú?
Dailene's mother, father, and sister emigrated to Tampa, Florida in 2015. Dailene stayed behind, but that wasn't the plan.
La familia de por parte madre fue la primera en irse, hace el proceso de reclamación para mi mamá. Y entonces el núcleo familiar entramos en ese proceso de reclamación. Fuimos todos para la embajada americana, mis padres, mi hermano y yo. Yo estaba preparada psicológicamente para irme. Y entonces en la entrevista, cuando empezamos a dar los papeles y todo, los míos los viraron para atrás en el ventanillo. La mujer le dijo a mamá que no podía ir. Y dice, no, ella tiene ya 21 años. Y no, y tiene que empezar el proceso de ella cuando lleguen allá, ustedes.
¿Cómo te sentiste?
Me sentí triste, pero en ese momento no podía como demostrarlo. Porque si... No podía demostrar así que estaba triste, porque entonces mi mamá iba a decir que no se iba.
A year after moving to the US, her mom requested a visa for Dailene. But it was too late.
¿Recuerdas qué fue lo que pensó cuando escuchó que la administración de Trump iba a cerrar la embajada?
Morirse. Porque ya sabía ya que eso era demorar el proceso y bueno, demorar que yo fuera para allá.
It's been 6 years since Dailene's family left Cuba, and Dailene is still waiting for her visa.
Mija, ¿qué has oído de lo del abogado que tú sigues?
No, eso todavía se coge su tiempito.
Dailene moved on with her life in Cuba. Then, in March, she learned her visa process was finally moving forward.
¿Cómo te sentiste cuando tu mamá te dio la noticia de que finalmente el proceso había comenzado?
Por una parte, súper feliz. Y por otra parte, caigo en la vida que tengo acá, de que el día ese que quizás me tenga que ir y mi novia se tenga que quedar, mi perrito. No se pueden hacer planes así. Es frustrante. Mi vida, como tal, socialmente, se ve afectada por la administración que hay allá.
Y esperar que la próxima decisión no te afecte.
Exacto, y esperar que la próxima decisión nos beneficie.
The FBI, CIA, CDC, NASA, NIH, none of them have produced evidence of attacks. In March, Biden created the Health Incident Response Task Force. But after 6 months, Pamela Spratlin, the diplomat running the task force, was gone. Spratlin's exit came after she reportedly declined to rule out the possibility of psychogenic illness. 2 weeks later, Biden passed the law to provide payments to victims afflicted by neurological attacks. It's called the Havana Act. The next week, U.S. personnel claiming to have been attacked in Havana spoke publicly for the first time.
I'll just play it for you so you can hear.
It was a lot worse earlier. It was like I had been seized by some invisible hand and I couldn't move.
Andrea, those stories are truly frightening. What do we know about who could be behind these attacks?
U.S. diplomats and CIA agents will be compensated for their injuries. But the Cuban people continue to pay the price.
Llevo 16 meses esperando la aprobación.
Llevo 2 años en proceso de reunificación con mi esposo.
2 años y medio en proceso.
4 años.
4 años y medio.
4 años.
6 años y medio.
7 años.
7 años en proceso.
Llevo 5 años en el proceso.
Reopening the embassy will help reunite thousands of families, but it won't solve a much bigger problem. El cierre de la embajada es solo la punta del iceberg.
quienes piensan que los Estados Unidos en este momento va a entrar en un diálogo de múltiples años con Cuba, yo creo que no entiende el momento político. Joe Biden no es Barack Obama.
For the Cuban people, it doesn't seem to matter if the U.S. president is Trump or Biden, Republican or Democrat. Al final, la guerra contra Cuba es la misma.